Welcome to the 12th lecture in this series. This one's on George R.R. Martin. I've got all the books laid out, as you see in front of me. They're called, you know, Game of Thrones after the first book, but it's actually the Song of Ice and Fire. Got a little bit more mixed up because of the TV series that we'll talk a bit about there, but I wanted to focus on these for the last part, in part because he's a contemporary author, and there's a lot of really interesting philosophical themes in this. I also did want to say a few other things before we completely get started. One is to say thanks to Stephanie Hannes and to the Brookfield Public Library for a year of hosting us here, to Andy for helping me to organize all of this stuff, and to you guys for all of your input and discussion. Like I mentioned last time, we've been renewed as a series for next year, so I have the full listing of what we're going to do. I solicited input and included some of it, and then, you know, smuggled in some that I was particularly interested in as well. And this time, the speculative fiction is going to be a little bit broader than just sci-fi and fantasy. We have some horror stuff. We have whatever you want to call Borges' thing, magical realism or philosophical something or other in there. I'm also putting together a website for the series that'll make it a bit easier to provide, say, like links to resources, you know, suggested readings, things like that, ahead of time. So things will be more organized next year, and you can look forward to that. So in these lecture and discussion sessions, you all know how it goes. We do a little bit of talk about critical appreciation of the author and some biography, and then we'll talk about world building. And this guy certainly did build a world. This Westeros and East and Esteros or Easteros are quite the complex. So we'll talk a bit about that, and then I've got actually six philosophical themes this time that I picked out, and there's more stuff that could be talked about. When you're dealing with a series that's this dense, there's so much going on. So, as usual, you know, we'll engage in some Q&A time at the end, but you can always, you know, jump in, ask a question, have a comment. You might, given how dense this stuff is, take a little break for questions here and there. One thing I do want to ask, though, before we actually get started. So, who has read all five of these? Mm-hmm. So, I have two. Who has read at least the first one? Okay, so, and then who's seen Game of Thrones, the TV show?
Two seasons.
Okay. Oh, you've only seen, well, you're going to get some spoilers in this one, then.
Well, it doesn't matter. We don't take HBO anymore. It was getting to be a little too much.
yeah.
I mean, I loved it because I like to keep track of everybody. That's like my Alzheimer's prevention program,
yeah,
to keep track of everybody and who they all are and how they're all warring and who they're going up against and all the intrigue. That I really like. Just at the level.
Well, that's interesting.
The level of violence is just
getting
to me.
I know a lot of people stopped watching after the Red Wedding.
Yep.
It was a big separation between people who had read the books and then people who were watching, maybe exposed for the first time. And then that was kind of like a critical tipping point for a lot of people who were brand new to the whole concept.
Yeah, they were like, what the hell is this?
Yeah, it was like...
I know people who were ticked off when, what's his name?
Oh,
Ned
Stark.
Ned
Stark.
Ned Stark
died in the beginning, you know.
Yeah.
But I know several people who were reading the books and they would be commenting and telling me about them.
Yeah.
And they were reading the books so they could figure out the series. And I said, just ask me because I got it all, you know, I got it all straight out. How do you do that? And that's how I do to keep my career.
You know, that's really interesting that you point that out. That was something I was going to talk about a little bit later on. One of the things that I think turns off a lot of potential readers and even watchers is the sheer complexity of how many different like plot lines and characters you've got going on. And I was talking with Stephanie beforehand. I was saying somebody should actually put together like a program like you do for baseball games, you know, where all the players are listed. You can tell, you can like write down, okay, this person's here, this person killed that person, and you can keep track of them. It could be like a PDF document or something. I don't know that anybody's done that, but this would actually benefit from it.
But don't you find that's true with all the world-building authors?
Well, it depends.
They're pretty complex.
It's a matter of how complex. I mean, are there more characters? I think there's more characters in this than there are, say, in The Lord of the Rings. Certainly more than in Gormenghast that we looked at last time.
Well, Tolkien doesn't tend to... I mean, it's almost like a turnover
issue.
He doesn't kill off as many.
No.
I mean, to your point, he kills off
plenty of bad guys.
Yeah, but when I read Game of Thrones, and I was actually, and I know Greg's going to talk about this a little bit, but I was turned on to it by an old friend who's like, you've got to check this out. And I was going to be on a 12-hour flight. So I said, okay, great, this sounds like a wonderful book to bring. And I got to the first page and was hooked. I just loved the way he wrote and the point of view and everything. But there are two parts in reading that first book where I had to put it down because he's such a brilliant writer that I was emotionally devastated at the fact that they could throw a child out a window and that Ned was beheaded. Sorry, I mean, spoilers. But
Drogo dies, too, right?
And when Khal Drogo, and that whole situation, he really has an unbelievable ability to completely pull you into the world. So,
pull the rug out from under you.
It's so rich.
He connects you with the characters, and then you really start to identify with things. And what really got me was the old Greyjoy thing, when they got Greyjoy, when they were working on him. That's when I kind of got just getting turned off.
That's hard to get.
And I said, he was like batshit crazy for so long. And then I heard, because I haven't seen the last couple of seasons, that he was sort of normalized again, and I was hanging out with...
Well, there's a redemption, but I wouldn't say normalized.
He's kind of, sort of, but not really.
Well, I don't know how you could be. I really took it.
So that's actually something that I was going to talk about. And I think part of what's... It's not unique to Martin, but he probably does this more than anybody else. He's weird in that he's willing to throw so much time and effort into developing a character, like Ned Stark, right? And Ned is clearly a good guy, and so he probably shouldn't die anyway, but Martin takes that rule off the table. But then there's if you really, really put a lot of time and effort into the character, I'm not going to kill it off, rule that we all assume. And Martin is perfectly willing to burn everything down.
Yeah.
Well, he takes the hero off and he lets the Lannisters in there who are just the anti-heroes, and he keeps all that,
I think his point of view writing, too, is something that separates him from others.
Well, let's talk about that then, too,
When you're reading the Tyrion point of view, I think part of his gift is that I realize I'm sounding super fangirlish here, but you actually feel like you're inhabiting Tyrion's worldview. And that's not something that's very easy to do, especially since he's switching.
Yeah.
I'd love to find out how he writes pathways. Is he writing a character up to a certain sequence, or is he literally jumping chronologically from kind of point to point?
One of the things that he said was that he developed his sort of way of going from this chapter, this character, this chapter, this character, and always in third person point of view, but with interior monologue from his journalism experience. Because he was a journalist for quite a while. He actually let's jump into some of the other stuff because this will all come up. So Martin himself a little bit of setting the stage. He's a contemporary living author. He's so contemporary that he's got fans angry at him right now for not churning these books out quick enough. He was born in 1948, so he's just approaching 70. And compared to the other people that we've been looking at, he's in a different generation. Even with the new wave of science fiction people like Zelazny, or Leguin, or Moorcock, they're at least 10 years older than him. Mm-hmm. Philip K. Dick is even older than that. He knew some of them, Zelazny helped him out early on in his career, but he's really a different kind of animal than the people that we've looked at so far. He's very involved with engagements with fans in a number of different ways. He is kind of, an avowed Luddite when it comes to his beloved word processor, right? I don't know if you guys know that story. He works on a very old DOS-based program. And the reason he does that is for the writing, so he's not distracted by all the other nonsense that's on our computers, right? So when he's writing, he's just on that program, which still works. But he has a blog, which is called Not a Blog, and he writes stuff in there regularly. He's been going to all the different cons for years and years and years.
He posts on Facebook.
Yeah, that's true. And, I mean, and he
and DOS.
Well, he's got a separate computer.
I know.
Yeah.
He posts on Facebook.
Well, and he's got a hand in the writing process for the TV show. You know, so he's very involved with things. He's won a lot of awards over the years as well, and he's probably, I would say at the present time, I'd be willing to say that he's probably the most famous sci-fi slash fantasy author, primarily because of the TV show, you know, and the effect that that's had. I mean, you could say Philip K. Dick has got a similar stature, but I think there's probably more. I mean, Dick is dead. He's been dead for a while. This guy's still out there. We're still waiting for book 6 and book 7. So.
Well, and even, I mean, I think it's funny because it's his celebrity that makes that kind of a known thing. Like, when is Martin going to finish? But my friend who suggested
it. His reclusive, but available celebrity.
Yeah, this
say.
Was years before
yeah.
the TV show was even a possibility. And people were like, when is he going to come out with the next book? Like, he's notorious for taking forever, right, to finish a project. But doesn't he do other side projects in between?
He does.
Which kind of drives
and
people
he edits
nuts?
And
yeah.
he... You know, and she probably likes to enjoy his life too.
Yeah, sure.
He just recently got married to his girlfriend of 35 years who's been living with him all that time.
Still in Santa Fe.
Yeah. He bought a movie theater there too, so he's diversified.
Is
he's
a technical
he's invested,
consultant?
He's,
what's that?
Is he a technical consultant for the series?
He is. Yeah, and then he gets pretty involved in
so he must do interviews then. I mean, that are
Interviews for that, but also he's like, there's always like a new interview with him coming out. Usually it's people asking the same questions, like, when's the next book coming out, or, you know, what's your writing process like, you know, things like that. So there's not an awful lot of new stuff. But he also does like writing workshops every once in a while.
And he's invested in the Vegas Meow Wolf project, like the kind
of
interactive, like, lifestyle art. I mean, it's just wild stuff.
Yeah. I mean, so, you know, if I'm doing that much stuff at 70, I'll be pretty happy myself. I wanted to say a little bit, Andy said something about how she got started reading Martin. I got started reading Martin because Andy recommended it and sent me this Game of Thrones book, and then I started reading it. And the idea was we were going to read our way through the series together.
Yeah.
And I kept reading, and Andy didn't. So for a while, I would just held off on it, and then I just said, I'm fine, I'm going to start reading it. And it was great, but then I had to, like, keep my mouth shut, you know, because of spoilers, you know. So, you know, with, like, the Red Wedding happens in which one? Storm of Swords or Feast of Crows? One of those two.
Storm of Swords.
Okay.
One because
so I had to keep quiet about
Storm,
the Red Wedding
Storm
for this.
Swords, yeah.
I had to keep quiet about Jon Snow. For this.
That was another one that got people really mad.
Yeah.
They knocked him off and then he resurrected.
Yeah. So, like I said, one of the biggest obstacles, I think, for a lot of people is the sheer complexity of the work. I too, was attracted to it because I like having these super complicated plots up there. I don't think most people like that sort of thing when they're reading it. And so the show has probably opened up a whole new fan base that wouldn't necessarily wade through all these books.
You have to keep notes.
But the series is still, I mean,
it's
disconnected and stuff, so that continues to attract people. Maybe they like it for the sex and violence, and they don't care about the characters of the plot. I don't know.
Well, there is certainly a lot of sex and violence in the whole TV series. And in
the books.
Yeah.
In the books.
Yeah. So... All right, so biography. Let's talk about his biography a bit. It's still ongoing. You know, we don't know exactly what's going to happen. He's born in Bayonne, New Jersey, and they end up moving to a housing project. He says early on in his life that his world was basically like five streets, And he had a really interesting thing that he says about when he was young in this first part. It says, I was born and raised in Bayonne, New Jersey, Queen City of the East Coast. And then he compares it to the other cities. He says, I never left Bayonne until I went away to college. This was essential for my development as a writer. You see, all of us have a deep inner need for stimulation, excitement, adventure, especially when we're growing up. Some of us do exciting things, meet exciting people, go exciting places. These poor chaps get used to reaching outward for excitement and grow up to be normal human beings instead of writers. I was luckier. In Bayonne, the most exciting things you could do were watch the oil slicks float past on the Kilvan Kull or play stickball in a parking lot. Being thus denied the adventures that others found in the world around them, I reached in instead of out and found adventures in my own head. Growing up in Bayonne, my head was positively yeasty with daydreams. All writers have minds that are constantly in ferment, bubbling away back there, inventing things and people and sagas. We have a technical term for this. We call it imagination. People are always saying to me, where do I get my crazy ideas? From Bayonne, that's where. And so he's actually saying this when he's in Wichita. He's like, and you can say the same thing about Wichita, by the way. you're better off growing up here than in some place that's more exciting with great opportunities. And that's what he, in fact, did. He started reading, you know, very early on, and then started writing, and he started telling stories. So he started making monster stories for his local classmates and the kids around. And then he'd sell them to the kids. And along with them came, like, doing a performance. The only reason he said he stopped doing that was the stories were giving the kids nightmares. And so the parents started complaining. So that put the kibosh on that. And I understand that. My dad did something kind of similar. He used to tell stories by the fireplace, and then the local neighbor kids were told not to go over there anymore because they would have nightmares. And, you know, he grows up there, and then he goes off and goes to Northwestern University. He earns his B.S. in journalism, and he said, why journalism? Well, because, when people found out in my family that I wanted to be a writer, they were like, you know, that's probably not a good career choice. Why don't you be a plumber or an electrician? They make good money. He actually looked up what the average income for a writer was. It was pretty low. For sci-fi writer, it was like, $1,200 a year or something. And 60 terms, so not a lot of money. So he figured journalism, at least with that, I can make some money, and he did that. And then, this is the when the Vietnam War is really heating up, he became a conscientious objector, and his attitude towards it is kind of interesting. He says that like a lot of kids in his generation, he was kind of a hawk, and it wasn't that he was anti-war per se. He was against this particular war and didn't want to get involved in it. And so he said, I asked for conscientious objector status. I wasn't a complete pacifist. I would have been glad to fight in World War II, but Vietnam was the only war on the menu. So I applied for the status, thinking that I would be rejected and I would have to make a further decision, either Army, jail, or Canada. And I don't know what I would have done. And he says, these were desperately hard decisions, and each kid had to make them for themselves. To my surprise, they gave me the status. I was later told that I was granted the status because our conservative draft board felt anyone who applied for the status should be granted it because that would be punishment enough. Everyone would say, you dirty, commie pinko, a draft dodger, it would ruin your life. So it doesn't actually ruin his life. Instead, what ends up happening is he starts alternative service with Vista, and he winds up in Chicago. So, he was out in Northwestern anyway, so that's how he wound up in this area. So he winds up working with the Cook County Legal Assistance Foundation, and because his degrees were in journalism, he said, they gave him a card that said Director of Communications and Education, and had them edit their newspaper and write their press releases, and that was pretty much it. He also starts making a bit of money getting involved in chess tournaments, and that ends up being an important thing for him. That dries up by about 1975, he says. There was no more money and doing that. And the whole time he's writing short stories and sending them out to sci-fi, you know, horror, fantasy places. He also has something kind of interesting to say about sci-fi and horror and fantasy. He says, well, you just dress the characters differently, and now you change the scenery and change the way things work, and you move from one to the other. It's still the same dialogue. It's still the same character development and all that. But he's doing that, and he's actually being successful. He has a marriage. He goes out to Clarke University in Iowa. He becomes a writer in residence. His wife eventually graduates, and now they're going to go down to Santa Fe. The trip down to Santa Fe, they have a huge falling out. By the time that they're in Santa Fe, they're ready to divorce. And so he's down there, and he's more or less on his own, but he's churning out works. And you notice he's already got some novels coming out. This woman, Harris McBride, who recently became his wife, but you know, becomes a very important figure in his life early on. He meets her in around 75, I think, and then by 81, she's moved in with him. And he's writing and writing and writing, and then sort of a catastrophe happens in his life. His book, The Armageddon Rag, does terrible, and it really throws him for a loop. And, you know, if people like it, nobody wants to buy it. So this is a big setback for him. He goes into writing for television. And this will be important for, like, when he's writing, you know, for Game of Thrones as opposed to writing the Song of Ice and Fire. And he writes for some pretty cool shows. He wrote for the new Twilight Zone. He was a really important writer on Beauty and the Beast. Ron Perlman had some really nice things to say about him. He said, this guy was, like, way out of everybody else's league. He didn't like writing for television that much, even though it paid pretty well and pretty reliably, because they would cut so much. They would take your ideas and they would leave so much stuff out. Now, by 91, he starts working on this Song of Ice and Fire. And working on it means reading lots of stuff, you know, doing research. Sort of like what Frank Herbert did with Dune, right? We talked about him reading for years and years before he finally actually gets working on it. And he starts writing some stories that will fit into this. And the whole time he's writing other stuff as well. Game of Thrones comes out in 96. He wins the Locus Award and the World Fantasy Award for that. Clash of Kings comes out. And that's not too long afterwards. That's 98, you know. So at that point, he's got a pretty good, you know, record for getting the stuff out. Storm of Swords, 2000, and then Feast for Crows. Notice, Storm of Swords to Feast of Crows, 5 years. So that's where people are starting to say, what the hell, where's the books? Now, originally, it was only supposed to be 3 books. And it keeps on getting bigger and bigger and bigger. We'll talk about why that's the case, as opposed to somebody like Tolkien, who was a bit more, you could say, disciplined in keeping things to a trilogy. Dance with Dragons, 2011, so now there's 6 years. And so I suppose if we're following that sequence, it should be 7 years from Dance with Dragons to the next one. Hopefully it's not going to be like that. But that's where we are in the present. And if we talk about his world that he's constructing, I gave you, you know, not a particularly great map, but at least it shows you where, like, some of the stuff is, and it was easy to print. Westeros is this continent here. That's where at least most of the first 2 books are happening, and then it kind of expands. Although I suppose the Daenerys story is all in this Essos island as well, which is much larger. But he created the maps, and he said it didn't take me much time to create these maps. He's not like Tolkien, where Tolkien painstakingly constructs not only maps, but languages and this and that. And you guys remember really early on we talked about the difference between the architect and the gardener. This is something that Martin came up with to try to explain how he differs from other world builders like Tolkien. He says that, here we go, There are many different kinds of writers. I like to use the analogy of architects and gardeners. There are some writers who are architects, and they plan everything. They blueprint everything. They know before they drive the first nail into the first board what the house is going to look like, where all the closets are going to be, where the plumbing is going to run. Everything is figured out on the blueprints before they begin any work whatsoever. Then there's gardeners who dig a little hole and drop a seed in it and water it with their blood and see what comes up and sort of shape it. They know what kind of seed they planted, whether it's an oak or an elm, or horror story or science fiction story, but they don't know how big it's going to be or what shape it's going to take. I am much more a gardener than an architect. So he's, you know, this story starts out as supposed to be a trilogy. Now it's supposed to be 7 books. He's actually said, if it has to be 8, then maybe it'll be an 8-book series. And it's the same thing with the characters. He creates the characters. He doesn't know exactly what they're going to be all the way down the line. And so they change and they grow over time, which is that's kind of cool. Now, what can we say about this world that he created? One of the things that he said about it is the 7 kingdoms have a very long history, and I haven't mentioned all of it, nor will I. There's even more stuff in the background that made it into the books. What do we have about this? Well, it's a medieval setting, that's pretty clear. And it's not just medieval in terms of like social structure and culture and social rules or technology, but also in how diverse the medieval period was. When we think of the medieval period and our cultural representations of it, we're thinking of knights, you know, and fair maidens and maybe, you know, dragons or something like that. And there's all that in there. But you've also got a group of people sort of like the Mongols, these Dothraki, you know, who live on this massive sea of grass. You've also got these free cities on the other coast. You've got weird things happening far up north beyond the wall with the free folk and, you know, the others who we get to glimpse here and there, and the Night Watch, who are a bunch of poor guys stuck on the wall.
The White Walkers.
Yeah, and you know, we've got the sort of Viking types, you know, with the Ironborn. We've got something that basically looks like Spain. And Martin has said, yes, Dorne is Spain, you know, no bones about it, down in the south. And then we've got these slaver cities over here. We've got all other things going on. So there's a lot of diversity within this world. And there seem to be some constants, but also some really major differences. And he'll tell us about it, you know, he'll explore it. But he hasn't made it all up beforehand. He knows, like, there should be something kind of like the Mongols, but we'll figure that out as we go along, you know? Westeros itself is called the 7 Kingdoms. There's really 9 main areas in it, and some of them correspond to these kingdoms. They were originally, going into the backstory, each one of them was its own separate kingdom. And in fairly recent history, these outsiders, the Targaryens, come in and conquer a number of these kingdoms. And then some of the others sort of pledge their loyalty to them. But there's conquest upon conquest upon conquest. In a way, it's like medieval Europe, but in a way, it's also sort of like Central America. You know, like when the Aztecs were conquered by the Spaniards, the Aztecs were just the latest new guys on the block who happened to conquer all these other places that had, you know, been around for a while, and they'd conquered other places, and they'd conquered other places. And so there's this overlay of culture on culture on culture that takes place over time and mixing and blending. There are these noble houses, and that's where a lot of the jockeying takes place, I'd say. Some of them are really great, you know, like the Starks, who are the kings of the north, right, until they become the wardens of the north. They're great rivals, the Boltons, the really terrifying guys who like to flay people, and the descriptions of them in the books are even scarier than the way they look in the TV show. The people like the Baratheons, or the Aarons and the Eyrie. These are all like big players, right? Or the Lannisters. And then you got all these like sort of little guys that are also noble houses, but they're pledged to somebody. There's a vassal system. And you go along with somebody, or you betray them, which happens quite a bit too. You've got all these professional organizations in the world. You've got the Meisters who are teaching all this knowledge, and they have a communication system with the Ravens. There's an Alchemist Guild. You could look at the Night Watch as kind of a professional organization, mostly of poor bastards who got stuck there on the wall. You've also got, you know, religious organizations with the Septons. Even the religion is very complicated. You know, there's the official religion of the Seven in the kingdom, but then there's the old gods in the north. And the Ironborn have their own drowned god. Arya spends a lot of time in the house of the many-faced god, and there's sort of a almost Manichaean thing going on with the Lord of Light and the enemy. And then over in Essos, there's all sorts of other things going on. So what do we have? We've got this incredibly complicated, vast world that Martin grew up. If we have this gardening metaphor, he didn't just plant one seed and let that grow. He, like, planted an entire field and then nurtured them all. And some of them killed each other. Some of them choked each other out. Some of them are parasitic. Some of them, you know, grew into big trees. Some of them are, you know, if we want to use this metaphor of trees, some of them grow into trees so big that they can't actually sustain themselves and they're going to fall over. And he just sort of charts this out, if we go along with that metaphor. The other thing to say about it is, we talked about this before, incredibly developed characters. And characters that he's perfectly willing to kill off if the story requires it. After pages and pages of development of these characters, with their backstories and making choices, and they grow, and then they're snuffed out.
That's such a great point. Because you wouldn't really have, I mean, I don't mean to take us off track, but as upset as I was about the Ned Stark issue, Arya Stark would not be Arya without her father's death. You know, I think that there's so many things, her need to be, she wouldn't be as fully Arya, at least, right? Like her
without her hatred,
her list, her vengeance,
and suffering,
her hatred,
and,
yeah. I mean,
and Sansa, too. Sansa is an interesting character who needs to grow. And, you know, in the first book, you just hate her because she's a spoiled...
Well, and she was responsible, I think, for the first direwolf death, too, right? That really bothered me.
Yeah.
I couldn't get past that.
The other thing he does is his characters are... It's not a clear hero.
They're
all flawed, all of them.
Yeah.
Some are worse than others.
Some are worse than others. Some are worse, but all of them are flawed.
Yeah.
And all of them are human. They're really human.
Yeah.
Cersei Lannister's pretty flawed.
Cersei.
I mean, this is something I was going to talk about a little bit later, but if you had to pick, like, who's the most evil character in the series or in the books, who would you pick? Cersei would probably be in the mix.
I think Ramsay.
That's
is
who I
hard
pick,
to like top for a couple of reasons.
For sheer.
There's something. Yeah, I mean, it's just
viciousness and.
I don't mean to like psychoanalyze them into like, you know, less malevolence than they actually possess in Cersei's case, but Cersei and Jaime, right, and Tyrion, like, in some ways, Tywin tops them all, like, combined.
You mean
you know?
in evil?
Yeah. Tywin, I think, is worse than the whole lot of them. Like, I see those as his creations. Like, his evil is so... And I'm not saying Ramsay Bolton's father was any less, you know, of a bad guy.
Pretty terrible.
But I think Ramsay himself, of his own sort of self-possessed evil, is pretty... dark.
You know, with Cersei, one of the themes that keeps coming up, and you get more of it in the later books, is this, if I was a guy, all this stuff would be okay for me, and I wouldn't have to put up with any of your nonsense. It kind of like drives her. With Tywin, there was something else that the books talk about as well, which is that his dad was kind of a screw-up, and like people laughed at him, and he was like, I'm never going to be like him. I'm going to be an iron ruler, and nobody's ever going to laugh at Lannisters again. With them, you can like point to, well, okay, they do terrible things, never trust them.
They do terrible things for power.
Right.
And
but you can understand
Ramsay, it's terrible things for the sake of doing terrible things sometimes. You know,
Joffrey's
degradation.
Joffrey,
if he had lived longer,
Joffrey
could have easily been the worst.
Yeah.
He had no conscience. He just had no sense of...
He reminded me, I guess, of
Ramsay?
Of Ramsay, yeah.
He's even worse than all. He's really a complete sociopath.
Yeah. Let me ask another question then, and then we'll get into some philosophical themes. So if we're talking about characters, and we can't say that there's any truly good character, but there are some pretty bad characters, who would you say is the most manipulative character in the bunch? I mean, you got Varys. Varys clearly pulls a lot of strings.
There's
Marjorie's
grandmother.
I was thinking about Marjorie.
What's her last name?
From Highgarden.
Yeah.
Martell.
Okay.
Yeah.
The Martells.
I haven't had any relationship with this for 3 years.
Marjorie's
so
grandmother.
I'm pulling here.
There's an intimation, and we're not going to know until we get the sixth book, that she's the one who killed Joffrey. That she poisoned him.
I can believe that.
Yeah.
Sure. Well, I thought that was already known.
No.
Mm-hmm. No. I mean, it's in like some of the fan stuff, I think.
Well, I don't, I mean,
maybe
how
on the
did
show.
I know that? Maybe I just figured it out. I don't know. How did I know that?
Well, there is
that.
A moment where in the show, I think she passes her the rose and said, I'm taking care of you like I did before. Like when she sends Marjorie away, I think Marjorie finds out that it was her grandmother who had something to do with the poisoning. And I agree that she's incredibly manipulative.
She's the most manipulative.
She's like a, she's
really
sort of like
than,
behind
more
the
than
scenes.
Peter
I don't think so. None of them are my choice for most manipulative.
Who's your choice then? For most manipulative.
Yeah, I mean, I think that there's kind of a toss-up. I mean, I agree with what you're saying about the grandmother, definitely.
Yeah.
And I feel like she, again, is kind of motivated, you know, by power and things like that. And you know, Cersei, I mean, all of the people we've named as having sort of evil threads.
Yeah.
But honestly, I mean, I think that, and she's dead now, I'm pretty sure. But the most manipulative one that they've introduced, or that he's introduced, was the Dornish woman who killed her brother. I mean, she couldn't stop, in a way. And she is dead now, right? The sister?
In the show, but not in the books.
Not in the books.
Yeah.
That,
well, maybe
that's
part of what's happening,
because
I haven't gotten
different.
That far enough.
Yeah.
Because she used the... girls. Like, there's aspects about her that emulated sort of what Daenerys was about, like kind of empowering the people without power and that kind of thing. But everything was for her own gain. And so she sold this game. She sold this game of kind of like the female warrior, and she sold the game of, you know, I don't know. I mean, I, again, this is probably my fault for not actually reading it and basing it on what I saw on the show.
I think I would disagree on her the same reason I would disagree about Peter Baelish.
Oh, yeah?
Because Baelish... You can understand what he's doing. I mean, you can almost predict what he's going to do. His manipulations are pretty transparent.
Okay.
Because he's very upfront about he's into the power, and that's what he's there for, and he's going to do everything he can to get it. And he's
and people don't take him as seriously.
People don't take him seriously, but he's not very under the table. He's pretty upfront.
Yeah,
about,
he's upfront, but he's done some pretty terrible
he
things.
He does some terrible things, but he doesn't manipulate people under the table the way other people do.
Well, although, too, I mean, what about, what's her face? The red woman. The red...
Yeah.
Oh, Melisandre.
Yeah, Melisandre,
yeah. She doesn't seem that manipulative.
Yeah, I don't think she's that manipulative.
You think so?
Well, yeah, I mean...
How so?
Because, well, I mean... Again,
well, but I don't think it's manipulative. I think she's a religious leader.
Yeah,
and
she's
pursuing her religious beliefs, and she's selling people on what she honestly believes,
including the burning of the daughter at the.
Yes.
Oh, that doesn't happen in the books.
Oh, it doesn't?
No.
okay.
No, but she, but she's doing it in line with her religion. She believes you have to kill the royal blood, the sacrifice of the royal blood. She absolutely believes it.
Yeah, there's some choices that the writers on the show made that are a little hard to fathom sometimes, you know.
Because it takes it out of character and what Martin has envisioned, or because it's sort of is just too sensationalist?
Martin himself is like, ah, you guys do it. That's fine.
It's creative license, and they do that a lot of times, you know, because they just feel this is going to add more value to whatever, you know.
Yeah.
It makes it a little more spectacular.
A lot of series.
That's what I'm saying. Like, if it's, I think,
too, that the series has to come to a neat end more quickly, so they got to kill more people.
The only thing I don't want if we're going to get a spoiler about something that happens to Daenerys, then I just need to close my ears.
Well, the show is ahead of where,
where
the books are when it comes to Daenerys.
Yeah,
the
nothing spoils it for me, because for me it's not about the end game, it's about the journey. So I just kind of go through the process. And
I'm just not ready to lose her yet.
Nothing really gets me spoiled, because
my money is on Daenerys being the winner.
my absolute favorites are Daenerys and Jon Snow. I mean,
there's a fan theory that they're going to wind up together, the two, that he might be a Targaryen. And
well, I think he is a
Targaryen.
Yeah.
Tyrion.
I love Tyrion.
Tyrion is my third favorite.
I mean,
yeah.
with this, we don't have all that.
Yeah.
We'll see what happens with book six. Let's talk about one of the big philosophical themes. So, Martin gets accused, because of all the death and you know, the fact that there aren't any like clear good guys, being nihilistic. That there's no moral compass whatsoever to the books. I don't actually think that's the case, but I think it's worth like talking a little bit about what this term nihilistic means. And it's a weird thing to say about a medieval period thing, because nihilism is something that's very modern. Nietzsche is a guy who talks a lot about nihilism, for example. He's not the first person to talk about it. There's other people like Turgenev who use the term. But when Nietzsche's talking about it, he talks about it as being what he calls the devaluation of the highest value. So like, you know, in the medieval period, you've got God in his heaven the devil below and everybody else somewhere in between. And then there's this famous, sort of death of God. And that doesn't mean that somebody like shoots God or something like that. It means that God is sort of a concept, loses its efficacy. And even the things that we substitute in its place, like say science, and the Enlightenment in place of God, that loses its efficacy. And after a while, people are like, well, nothing really runs the show. Nothing really matters. And I don't see that actually happening in this myself. I see people accusing him of doing that, but it seems like there are, at least for the characters, there are values that they hold and try to, encompass. Some of them are worse than others. Some are better than others. Some of the characters genuinely seem concerned with something like a common good, like Jon Snow or Daenerys. I think that's part of what we find attractive about them. But what we can say is that there is an awful lot of death, and a lot of what seems to be almost senseless death. So it's not the case that virtue is rewarded, that if you're a good guy, you'll make it through the battle or anything like that. There's a lot of good guys who are killed off. As a matter of fact, there's a scene, and I think it's in the fifth book, where somebody is killed precisely because he's a good man. Is that in the fifth book or the fourth book?
I don't remember.
Varys.
It's been a while since I've read that.
Varys kills Kevin, the uncle of Jaime and Cersei and Tyrion, and he tells him explicitly, as he's killing him, I'm killing you because you're a good guy. I know that you would probably keep things from descending into chaos, and that's, I need chaos, so you gotta go. Sorry, buddy. But he's recognizing the goodness of him when he's doing it. He's not saying, well, I just like to do evil for its own sake or anything like that. Bad characters don't always come to bad ends. Some of them come to ends that seem excessively bad. Theon is a great example. Theon is kind of a betrayer and a weak guy, but what happens to him is pretty horrific.
Yeah.
So, you know, and then we can talk about Ned Stark, and we can talk about what happens to Renly Baratheon from his own brother. We can talk about the Red Wedding. These are all cases. I don't think this is really nihilism. This isn't, you know, the tearing down of the highest values. These are more, death is there, and it's staring everybody in the face, and it can happen to any of the characters at any time. They're all vulnerable to it. Just like,
it's not aligned with medieval periods.
Yeah, it's
history.
That's pre-modern.
During the medieval times, well, there's lots of senses of death.
Yeah, in medieval literature.
It's pre-modern philosophy.
It's pre-modern, yeah.
Yeah.
So you don't have the sense of the Enlightenment and the other higher levels of consciousness that we've gained over the years. It was.
All about power and land and control.
It's interesting because when you said that too, I think that there's connections that I hadn't thought of before. But even, I mean, the Canterbury Tales or Dante, you know, I mean, it seems like Martin calls
Well, Dante, everybody
gets
what they deserve.
Yeah, but I mean, some of the descriptions and some of the ways in which people are treated and some of the sort of like great, you know, the great journeys and the, you know, the sort of, I hadn't really thought of it. I've never thought of it in the context of medieval philosophy or literature before.
Pre-modern times were like that. I mean, there was a book out about, you know, a while back about how violence, it seems like we're in a violent world, but it's nowhere near what it was. And they're saying in medieval times, if you were just walking down the street, somebody looked at you funny, so they'd stab you with a knife, and that would be it. I mean, it was just so common. It wasn't nihilistic, it was just there was no value on life. And we get better as we grow.
Part of what was a struggle in moving from the medieval times into modernity and then into the Enlightenment was developing not just like norms, but enforcement of norms that would like cover everything. And because what you had in medieval times is just sort of like a patchwork of all sorts of stuff, and there would be rules. Like you couldn't just, you know, somebody be walking down this street, you can't kill them, but they're from that village over there and they're walking down the street, well, okay, club them, you know. And it would be this whole complicated set of stuff. And so one of the things that, and this was fought with violence, you know, we eventually get the nation state. And the nation state comes about in part by the kings and the people who are working for the kings, often the bourgeoisie, saying, enough of this nonsense. You know, you nobles need to rein it in. You peasants need to quit beating each other up, you know. Roads actually need to run straight, you know, and that's a hard won achievement. It's something we take for granted, right? Because we're kind of used to that, except when things break down, like you're saying. But in a lot of cases, that chaos was the norm. Let's talk about the second big philosophical theme. You're talking about power. So one of the key questions that's involved with it. There are some people who are just driving for power, and they view power as a good or they're right, and other people are in the way. But one of the things that you see happening in this and also in medieval times is people have to make a case for why they ought to be the one to rule. It's not enough just to conquer. You can't hold territory with people who are like, well, you're illegitimate. I don't like you. We're going to, you know, eventually poison you or something like that. You need to develop something like legitimacy. And so there's a lot of appeals to like loyalty. You know, hey, you're pledged to our house. You need to send your troops and fight with us. Or, you know, like at the very beginning, why does everything, you know, blow up? Because Robert dies and his son is being impugned as a child of incest, which he actually is, which would make him illegitimate. And then his brothers both claim the throne. Right? And we see over and over again, as things get more and more progressively broken down, more and more claims being advanced to people why they should be the person in charge, you know? And they have competing viewpoints about this. And what's really interesting is their arguments aren't all, I'm better than that guy, or, you know, I deserve it, or something like that. Some of them will make arguments appealing to some kind of higher good. Like, wouldn't you like order restored so we don't have all this craziness going on? Peter Baelish is kind of, that's sort of what drives him and his appeal. Wouldn't you like things to work? That's more attractive than just saying, well, I'm the Lord, so obey me, you know. You can threaten people. Some of the characters who are concerned with power genuinely seem to be concerned with something like a common good. Jon Snow is an example of that. And Ned Stark was, too. But Jon Snow has to grow into leadership roles where he is trying to figure out, and this is what gets him perhaps killed, we don't really know. He's trying to reconcile all these competing viewpoints. Who else is doing that? Daenerys is doing that, right? Mm-hmm. She starts out, she just jumps like from one problem into another, and it keeps getting bigger and worse, right? Now I'm gonna take over the call and I'll rule that well. And then we go to a city and there's a lot of slaves here. Let's free the slaves. That'll be good, right? And then it just like descends into chaos and there's war. And she keeps trying to do the right thing. Why? Because she actually wants to be a good ruler. She wants to be somebody who deserves to rule, not just somebody who happens to have power. Who else would you say is like that? Who's trying to, in some way or another, rule for a common good?
I mean, Tyrion.
Tyrion.
Yeah.
How's
yeah.
it Tyrion? Tyrion. Yeah.
Yeah.
Those are the only three that are. Yeah. The rest are just.
What about Jaime as the books progress?
Well, Jaime's redemptive. He's getting a little more that. I don't know if that like large woman is in the story.
Oh,
Brienne,
yeah,
of Tarth.
She is.
Yeah.
Yeah. Or just in, I couldn't remember her name. She's large, but
she's a giant. Yeah.
Yeah, giant. Okay. I think he's come along a little bit with that. And,
yeah.
But I think he was thrown in. Like you said, the father Tywin. Having him for a father, you know why his kids are messed up. And I think that, he could have been, I think he could have been a really good guy, but first of all, he was, dubbed a Kingslayer,
yeah.
And he was put in that role. He wasn't given the power that he wanted, he was put in a different position, fell in love with his sister, well, that was a downfall.
Yeah.
And then, always, never achieving in his father's eyes. And he was, but I think he had some goodness in him that is just coming out in little bits and pieces.
I think him losing his hand,
yeah, that was another one.
Had him, he had,
because he was one of the best swordsmen.
Yeah.
He had to deal with being a person who was not the best swordsman anymore,
yeah.
Who was not the best soldier anymore.
Yeah.
He
no
had
identity.
To redefine who he was.
Right.
He had to redefine who he was and made him a better person. Because he had to really look at who he wanted to be.
Yeah.
He was sitting in that mud, when he was in prison for so long.
What about Varys? Varys is serving the Targaryens.
Mm-hmm.
So he's serving the old regime. But he does seem to be trying to work things out for the best. I mean, I mentioned that he kills Sir Kevin. But it's almost like a utilitarian argument there. We need a bit of chaos right now so that we can finally have real order and the Targaryens back in charge. Would you say he's somebody who's concerned with the common good or not?
I think he's concerned with his good. And I think he creates situations where...
For Varys is good? What's his good?
Well, it's to his advantage to have the Targaryens in power. And he's blinded to any other solution.
Varys is the eunuch, right?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. So he creates situations where he can stay comfortable and out of harm's way. I mean, him. Granted, he does risk himself,
yeah.
Like smuggling, Tyrion, and he takes.
Yeah.
But he's always then creating a sort of dynamic of someone being indebted to him, and or him being sort of like a little bit more important to the conversation. He's
yeah.
not truly serving any crown, really. I mean, he's serving himself.
He's self-serving.
But he uses it very effectively, I think, to kind of create power structures that keep him informed and also sort of like, you know, he can manipulate things and move things about. I mean, someone who I think is dedicated to the common good and is a very kind of unlawful and sort of scandalous person is, now you have to remind me of his name, but the guy who's accompanying Jamie everywhere. The sellsword.
Oh, Bronn.
Yeah.
Well,
I mean, I think he's fantastic.
Bronn.
He's an interesting guy, yeah. I
mean,
he
wasn't accompanying Jamie, he was accompanying Tyrion.
Yeah.
He was Tyrion's man.
For a little while,
didn't he go with Jamie to rescue?
For a little while.
Yeah.
Yeah, but he was Tyrion's man.
Yeah.
He gets elevated to knighthood.
He's someone who's very upfront, like, here's the deal. I'm here, you get what you pay for.
I would say that he's an example of somebody who's straightforward. He doesn't seem to be worried about, like, a larger common good. If he's in, like, a group of people, I think you can count on him not to screw you
over. What I'm saying is I see Varys sort of as akin to him.
Okay.
Like, they're not bad, but they're just simply
doing...
I mean, you talk about utilitarian, you know...
Reasoning, yeah.
I feel like he's possessed of the same sort of...
Well, this is probably a good place to make a transition, then, to one of the other themes, which is... we could call it a moral perspective of the gray, because Martin likes that term. He says, I prefer to work with gray characters rather than black and white. This is one of his big criticisms of Tolkien, for example. You can see that here, actually, in one of the quotes. He says... This is the last one. Ruling is hard. This is perhaps my answer to Tolkien, whom, as much as I admire him, I do quibble with. Lord of the Rings had a very medieval philosophy. If the king was a good man, the land would prosper. Look at real history, and it's not that simple. Tolkien can say that Aragorn became king and reigned for 100 years, and he was wise and good, but Tolkien doesn't ask the question. What was Aragorn's tax policy? Did he maintain a standing army? What did he do in times of flood and famine? And what about all those orcs? And he actually says, does he go off and, like, engage in ethnic cleansing to get rid of that? Or, you know? In real life, real-life kings had real-life problems to deal with. Just being a good guy wasn't the answer. You had to make hard decisions. Sometimes what seemed to be a good decision turned around and bit you in the ass. It was the law of unintended consequences. I've tried to get at some of these in my books. My people who are trying to rule don't have an easy time of it. Just having good intentions doesn't make you a good king. A wise king. And he says, the war that Tolkien wrote about was a war for the fate of civilization and the future of humanity, and that became the template. He's talking about the Lord of the Rings as being sort of an allegory for World War II. We knew the Nazis were terrible, and they better not triumph, and all that. He says, I'm not sure that's a good template. The Tolkien model led generations of fantasy writers to produce these endless series of dark lords and their evil minions who are all very ugly and wear black clothes. But the vast majority of wars throughout history are not like that. There's only a few wars that are actually worth what they cost. And then, you know, he actually says, I prefer to work with the gray characters. I have an instinctual distrust of conventional happy endings. And I think, you know, we often talk about morality and we say, well, it's not so black and white. There's shades of gray. And when we do that, that's kind of a way of turning thought off, because we say it and then we're just like, okay, so we're not going to talk about it anymore. People do their things and all that. What's more interesting is when we explore the gray and we say, well, how gray is it? Is it really dark gray? Is it gray because it's what we call, you know, Charles Skirl, where there's black and white all mixed in together, so there's goodness and badness all kind of... tangled up together? Or is it just gray because somebody just has their way of being? Like, when I think about somebody who's uniformly gray, I think of Walder Frey. He likes to eat, he likes to screw, he likes to be in charge of his castle, and that's pretty, he likes to run things, that's pretty much it. And anybody who gets in the way, he'll just chew them up, he'll tell them stories, and then, you know, have a red wedding. And it's not really... He's the kind of guy who, you know, in contemporary time would say, hey, it's just business, you know?
Isn't he the one, though, who's like...
He's a disgusting guy.
He's incestuous with his daughters.
Well, no. He's not incestuous with his daughters.
No.
He just gets a whole bunch of new ones. He has, like, a whole bunch of young wives. So he's kind of a lech.
Yeah.
And he has a ton of kids. And he treats them all pretty terribly.
Yeah.
And, you know, he's gray. He's not black like Ramsay Bolton. But, you know.
He's not going to go out and try to conquer the other kingdoms and take over.
Yeah.
Just leave me alone. Just.
That seems like a different kind of gray than, say, a Peter Baelish.
Yeah.
Where there's almost like a, you know, an opaqueness there. And you never know. It's gray because the black and the white are always kind of mute, you know, moving around and muted together.
Yeah, I guess he's gray, kind of like dirty water. Is
yeah,
also gray.
He's a pretty dark gray.
That's the thing is we could, you know, when we're talking about these gray characters, we want to explore, well, how, you know, what's the grayness like? People are doing what they think best to do. We can look at their motivations, and Martin has them tell us about them. Sometimes they lie, right, the characters, but they engage in interior monologue, they talk to other characters, sometimes they teach them lessons. We can figure out who these people are. We can figure out, for example, that Ramsay Bolton is a sadist and just loves torturing people, you know, because he tells us, you know.
And things, and animals. I mean, he tortures everything.
That's true, yeah. Now, it's interesting because, you know, there's plenty of philosophers who would be perfectly willing, without compromising on their being, morality, or things like that, to say, yeah, that's the way things really are, is most of the time people are not entirely good. Some of them would even be idealists like Plato. Plato gets, you know, kind of a bad rap for talking, you know, there's justice and courage and there's these forms of it. And there's an ideal that we can conform to. But Plato says, no justice in the world that we experience is ever truly justice. It looks like justice on this side, and you can go around and look at it on this side, and it's not. Only the form that we can't actually see or touch or smell that exists apart from us is truly pure. That could be the world of Martin. You know, we can have these great stories with characters who aren't, you know, good guy wears a white hat, bad guy wears a black hat, and still have a sense of there being better and worse.
A lot of non-duality.
What's that?
I said a lot of non-duality.
Yeah.
As you talk, I'm thinking of the book of Ecclesiastes.
Oh, okay.
Because the message in the book of Ecclesiastes is basically, hey, life's good, it's bad. You know, sometimes it's great, sometimes it's not. Get over it. Move on.
Yeah.
You know,
well, Ecclesiastes
it's all gray. It's very gray.
It also has, like, you know, you can be a good guy, and that's great, but don't expect a reward.
Yeah.
You know. You
can be a bad guy, and
The non-good behavior, it might not be good for what's happening, but it's good for the person. Like, if a guy goes and robs a bank, it's not good for the bank, but it's good for him because now he's got the money that he needs for something else. So there's really, where do you put the judgment? It's like a non-dual situation. You can always find, you know, we sort of make commitments as society as to what is good and bad. But if you want to look at it from a philosophical point of view,
you can say that something is good for that person, but still not good in general, because people can be like mistaken about what their good is.
Well, as I said, I mean, as society, we come up with a set of the ethos that say this is what is good and bad, and we set that up.
Although that ethos is so easy to manipulate.
Manipulate, right? Absolutely.
You know?
But then you've got
the unintended consequences issue.
There's that too. Yeah.
Like Daenerys freeing all the slaves.
Yeah.
And then she has the unintended consequences because
what the hell do you do with them?
What do you do with them, and how do you feed them? And they've always lived as slaves, so now what? And there's lots of unintended consequences in our own world.
Yeah.
Well, it was like when the slaves were freed in the South here. They didn't know what to do. I mean, they've been a generation of slavery, and they had nothing, you know, set in place on how to do anything. But
there have been lots of laws where we had good intentions.
Yeah.
Or understanding consequences.
Or people took an action. It might not even have been a law, but like somebody comes in and like, I fix this now. And sure, it's fixed in a way. And now it's screwed up in this way too. You know?
Mm-hmm.
It's sort of like trying to tune a guitar with a warped neck. You know, you get one string right, and now you start working on the other string, and you get that string to the note that it's supposed to be, and now this string's back screwed up again. You know, and you keep playing around with it until the strings break. And so that's actually another good transition into another philosophical theme. And I'm going to bring up some other philosopher, who's Thomas Hobbes. Hobbes is, if you only know one phrase from him, it's probably his quip about life being nasty, brutish, and short. Have you ever heard that quip? He's saying life without some sort of authority that we can agree on is nasty, brutish, and short. And Hobbes is writing after the English Revolution and Civil War and the ascendancy of Cromwell, the first totalitarian state in the modern era. And so he knows what he's talking about, you know. And he's a bit pessimistic, a bit more pessimistic perhaps than we need be about human affairs and the way human beings work. But there is kind of a Hobbesian dynamic going on in Game of Thrones. Hobbes said that, well, there's two things that are really, actually three things that are really important about what he said. One is he talks about a kind of fictional state of nature. State of nature is when we don't have an authority who decides cases for us and tells us what to do. He gives us those norms that we have to follow along even though we don't particularly like to, just so, you know, I don't steal your stuff, you don't steal my stuff. Without that, we're driven by our passions. And so maybe I like your stuff, so maybe I'm going to take your stuff. And that's one of the things that goes on. Now you, realizing that I'm eyeing your stuff up, might say, I better get the drop on this guy and take him out before he takes my stuff. That's the second motive for human conflict, Hobbes says. It's called, you know, anticipation. And now if I know that you're thinking that way, maybe I should get the drop on you before that. And you see how things start to escalate? So things are already bad in that way. And then Hobbes says, put into the mix vanity, the fact that people want to be valued more than other people. And you've got a situation that's primed for everybody to be at war with everybody else. The only reason they wouldn't be is they're getting something else out of it. So what's the remedy for that? You need some sort of what he calls a social contract. And that means you need to have an agreed upon set of rules, but you have to have an authority figure to enforce that. Because rules without authority, who's going to obey them? You get the free rider problem, right? You'll obey the rules. I won't, because then I'll benefit from you obeying them. The other thing that Hobbes brings up, where you know, it becomes essentially totalitarian, Hobbes says that we need to get rid of Aristotle and Cicero and all these people who write about other ways of organizing society. And most of the religious doctrines, too. As a matter of fact, the sovereign will decide all of that stuff. And if you teach something that goes against what the sovereign teaches, let's kill you. Because you're, as he says, reawakening the war. And the idea is that within societies, there's always like a war just ready to break out. You know, there's conflict lines, sort of like, you know, fault lines with earthquakes. And all it takes is for something to go off a little bit, and now we're ready to riot, and we're ready to start killing each other. So let's make sure that doesn't happen. Let's get everybody, in, not only in terms of authority, but intellectually on the same page. Let's have standard teaching across, you know, about moral topics across all the curricula, so nobody gets out of line, and it'll be like a paradise. We'll all be able to go about our business and nobody will mess with anybody else. That's Hobbes' solution. A little bit parodied here. But what's happening in Game of Thrones, especially in Clash of Kings, right? This is the second book where you have five kings. Why do you have five kings? Well, because people were like, well, we'll have our own kingdom. King of the North again. Screw the South. You know, the Ironborn, like, well, we'll have our own king. And it starts breaking down further and further and further, right? That's like what Hobbes is describing. So how do you reconstruct something after that? That's you know, a key question. One of the other things that I wanted to talk about as well, and I'll run through this really quickly, but I want to propose it as an idea to you. So we talked about characters like Jaime, right? And growing up in the Tywin Lannister household, you're probably not going to have a very good childhood. And then he had to be the Kingslayer and all that. This is what I call inheriting a moral dilemma. So there's all these characters that are not bad people, but they have to make terrible choices. do I go with loyalty or do I do what's really right? I can't do both. And, you know, when we have genuine moral dilemmas, it really bothers us. Why does it bother us? Because we recognize that either way we have to sacrifice something that's good, something that's worthwhile, right? Do I, and we have all sorts of ones that we face in our daily life. Do I work really hard at the office or do I spend time with my kids, right? Can't do both of them. You know, if I don't, you know, work really hard, then maybe I don't get ahead, and then my kids don't have the opportunities. But on the other hand, you know, neither way turns out to be great, right? And usually there isn't a way of reconciling all these things. What happens in these stories is characters are put into more and more and more dilemmas as things spiral further and further out of control. So who are some, like Daenerys, right? But Jon Snow is another case in point. What do you do? You know, do you work with Stannis or not? Do you bring the free folk in, even though you know that it's going to turn the rest of the Night's Watch against you, or not? What do you do? And so, you know, when you're working these dilemmas out, you can either decide for what's easy or you can decide for what's best. But when you do decide for what's best, you're losing some other stuff. And people will, in fact, hate you for the decision that you make. And that's what happens time and time again. So I think that's kind of a dynamic. I don't know. This isn't something I've seen in the philosophical literature, but I thought that it was kind of something that suggested itself. What do you guys think about that idea? Does it make sense of what's happening in the stories, or am I off on this? Or
I think you're on.
Yeah.
Things what happens in life.
Well, we have a lot of world
just,
life.
Just what happens in real life.
I was just thinking about something you said. You know, and I don't know how much has been done with sort of like psychoanalytic readings of all of this as connected to philosophy.
Thrones?
Yeah.
I don't know.
But it seems like part of what you're talking about too is I'm thinking about the characters who really embody that. They've all had to experience some form of liberation from their family of origin too. Like they've all ventured outward, right? So Daenerys in many ways is in conflict, but part of what made Daenerys Daenerys was being saved by her terrible brother, right?
Yeah.
Who, you know, and so when she's trying to free others, I think what she's trying to give them is that liberating experience, not really recognizing that she had there was a shift in almost sort of Khal Drogo wasn't a father figure necessarily. I mean, and there's all kinds of things you could say about their relationship as a result of that, but he did assume that kind of like role for her. And Tyrion becomes Tyrion most, in terms of complex balance when he kills his father and leaves his family origin.
Yeah.
I just, you know, I think that Arya on her journey
is sort of leaving his family too.
Well, Jaime in many ways loses his connection to his familial bond when he loses his hand because he's not necessarily the Kingslayer anymore.
Yeah.
And he finds a home in Brienne and he's able to escape Cersei. You know, because you had said he falls in love with his sister. I think it's the other way around in some ways. I think she just seduced him, you know, into, because the description is never, I think he loves her, but I think the sexual component of their relationship, it's always described from what I've read, and I haven't finished again, but she is the desirous one. He is the one who sort of like either reacts with anger or reacts with a passion that's kind of based in some sort of like desire to just be free of it or hatred in some way. It's not a fulfilling sexual relationship for him in the way that it's described.
I think she does that to some extent, and I haven't read the books and I have only seen some of this scene, but just looking at her, and you mentioned this before, as her being a woman, I think she really wants this power and she really thinks she deserves this power. And
oh,
she
sure.
can't get it because she's a woman. So she is going to use any, you know, this is her exercise of power.
Oh, sure. If she could be Daenerys standing there speaking Dothraki and being like, get it together, people, because I'm the one, you know, I think that would be her dream in many ways, is to have that kind of command over armies and everything.
Yeah, she's forced to exercise it through being a wife or being a mother or things like that.
Birthing kings.
Yeah.
Whereas Daenerys is unquestionably on the same level as any king. But not, you know what I mean? Like, she's got, I think her power is just more,
I suppose you could say Jon Snow, an area.
Well, Jon Snow
is a
bastard child,
yeah.
So he's free of his family and can kind of go on this journey a little bit.
He's freed of the Stark family when he has to go to the Wall. Really.
Yeah, but that's what I'm saying. Like, there's interesting, and you know,
yeah.
And
that's a good point.
What's his good friend who marries the girl who left?
Oh,
the father?
Sam.
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 So Sam's big woman is standing up to his father.
Situation.
But he stands up to him and he leaves. Like, there's all of this sort of...
That's not in the books, though.
Yeah, there's a theme going through.
Yeah.
About shaking the dust off your feet, if you want to go back to the
yeah.
terms.
Yeah.
But that's when they become most sort of... I think what you're talking about is this, the ability to contain this complexity, you know?
So family loyalties, in a way, or the family situation confines them to... certain role.
Yeah, and in a way, like, when Theon and his sister reconvene, when the uncle comes back, and then they're, like, forced away. I mean, I don't know, again, if that happens in the books, I didn't get to that point.
But, yeah.
But they form a different relationship of balance, and they're both healing in ways, and, you know,
Well,
I think...
that part doesn't happen in the books.
Okay, so
yeah.
Take that
so,
with
well,
the
okay,
list
what
then,
happens
but...
to Theon in the books? just
oh,
it's
terrible.
does anybody care if it's a spoiler alert? I mean,
he becomes, like, a double traitor. Because, you know, he betrayed the Starks for his own people. And then he's forced, as after assuming the role of Reek and after being flayed and all this other stuff, to betray the Northmen into surrendering. At Moat Kylan, it's called.
Yeah.
And then they're all flayed. Ramsay Bolton flays all of them. He knows that he's involved in that, and he does manage. The only redemption that he really has is managing to sneak.
Doesn't he do something with Sansa?
Well, Sansa's not actually that. That's a little bit different in the books. Sansa's in the Eyrie with Peter Baelish, and it's somebody else that is married to Ramsay, and they are pretending that she's Arya. But she's actually one of the serving girls.
Sansa
the reason,
escapes.
Yeah.
Sansa
the reason,
escapes.
Sansa's married off to Ramsay, isn't she?
Not in the books.
Yeah.
Okay.
In the
all right. I haven't seen this. I just hear stuff, so
yeah.
I don't know what's... You know.
Well, the show is pretty terrible.
Yeah,
it's awful.
Yeah, the marriage to Ramsay is pretty terrible.
Well, that's
show.
What I heard.
Yeah.
And we have reason to believe, based on all sorts of cryptic statements, that as the next season enters, that Sansa will actually be carrying Ramsay's child.
Well, that, again, isn't in the book.
I know, but what I'm
yeah.
saying is in the show. When you're
mm-hmm.
saying you hear all sorts of things, I think that's part of why there's... Because that was one of the major cliffhangers.
Well, that's... This is a good place for the last big theme that I was going to bring up. And it's sort of a question. Which characters develop their character? Not just in the sense of, like, you know, we get to know more about them, but they become... I don't necessarily want to say better people, but... Fuller people.
Fuller
people. Like Sansa, for example.
Oh, yeah.
She learns through suffering, right?
Yeah.
Peter Baelish, you know, we see more of his character, but he's still the same stuff, right?
Arya.
Oh, I see Arya.
Definitely.
Arya.
Yeah.
Jaime.
Yeah.
Daenerys.
What about Jon Snow?
Jon Snow.
Yeah.
Sam.
Snow.
So is it primarily, if you think about it, is it primarily the development takes place in the Lannister household and the Stark household? And then the Targaryen household?
Well, they're the kind of the main people.
That's the main.
Yeah.
So,
I mean,
that's
I don't
right
see...
That runs through
that's
it.
That's
okay. Yeah.
I don't see a lot in the others.
Well, you're not going to see, I mean, how much of a role does the Baratheon boys, and they're just vying for the power.
Well, so Stannis is an interesting guy. In the show, he lets... Massilia burn up his kid.
Mm-hmm.
He dies, you know, fighting Ramsay Bolton. That hasn't happened. Neither of those things happened in the books. Because there's also Davos too. I mean, Davos is involved as well. Stannis, I wouldn't say like changes over time, but you get to see more and more of what his sort of like. It's always got to be the right thing. We're going to do the right thing, even if it, you know, if nobody likes it.
Yeah.
You get to see it play itself out. He really is honorable.
Well, I was just saying, he has noble intentions.
Yeah.
Except for hooking up with that Red Witch or whatever, you know.
Well, then you got Bran.
I was just going to say Bran.
Yeah.
But Bran almost fights against the development of his character from at times, you know? I think he's...
Yeah.
Well, in his case, it's not so much development of character as an evolution into something else.
Yeah,
a revealing
right,
of
yeah.
whatever is...
He's evolving into
yeah.
something else.
Yeah.
Morphing.
Yeah. So, I think that he fights the evolution from being a human to whatever he becomes.
Okay.
His dagger wolf.
That makes sense. Again, we don't get to see quite as much of that in the fifth book as I think they revealed in the show.
Was the Hodor in the book?
No.
Yes. Well, Hodor's in the book.
No,
well,
but the hold the door.
Yeah.
Oh, no.
That may not even make it into the sixth book. I don't know.
Yeah.
I mean,
that was such a moment
things.
In pop culture, though. That was really interesting.
Yeah.
I mean, every elevator I was in after that had little pictures of even
Hodor,
our building
yeah.
of Hodor on the door hold door button.
People taped it over.
Yeah.
I think that's sort of a good place to bring it to a close, and then any discussion that we want to have after that. There's so much more happening in the show than we've got. You know, this gives us kind of like an ending point where. We just don't know. Is Jon Snow going to be alive like he is on the show? We don't know.
Yeah.
You know what's happened to Daenerys? She just flew off with her dragon. We don't know. You know, it'll be interesting to see what happens if and when the book comes out. If it doesn't,
it's anyone's guess.
Well, then we've just got the show.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So
the next thing you're free HBO, I'll have to pick up a few more episodes on the show here.
But I was mentioning George Martin has been posting on Facebook politically
oh.
lately.
Yeah.
And the latest one
he
I've
was
seen,
a Clinton supporter.
Yeah, the latest
yeah.
one I've seen is I told you winter was coming.
That's classic. Winter's here.
Yeah. I mean it's a problem for him as an author. Because he's got so many things to distract him from getting the writing done.
Wasn't it funny, though, too? I think people, even before the show, again, like at the cons and stuff, people
yeah.
would be like, where's the book? Like, we're entitled to it, you
exactly,
know? Like,
yeah.
he shouldn't be doing this. He owes us the book.
He doesn't
know?
Get to have a life.
Well, that happened,
he can't
it,
vacation.
That happened with Asimov. It happens with Gabaldon. The Gabaldon's fans
oh.
are all over her. When's the next book coming
yeah.
out?
Yeah.
Well, I'm
it's
only
almost,
in book five of that. I gotta,
the Goldens, yeah.
yeah.
It's almost like
this
being
a
prisoner of your own success, right?
Yeah.
Well, except, you know, in this case, it's such a popular, well-financed series
yeah.
on HBO. I don't understand quite his contractual basis for letting it take its own course substantially. I mean, not more than half of his books, but I mean...
Yeah.
Why do you, he's very successful. I mean, I just don't get why he's ceding creative control, especially with departures from his main storyline and characters.
Wasn't
I mean,
it,
I don't
wasn't
know
it because
why.
We, I mean, the...
He doesn't need the money, I don't think.
No,
don't
but the show is quickly eclipsed, or not eclipsed, but surpassed where certain storylines had gone, right?
Well,
yeah.
They said they were going to be deviating from the book.
Well, no, but why does the author,
who
creates this other world, you know, allow... third party, financially driven for other purposes, to sort of take his
it's a good question, yeah.
creative world and sort of say, well, we're going to do this because maybe it plays
because
better, or our audience is this demographic, and your audience for your books is a different demographic.
That's artistic license.
No, but why does he give it up?
Well,
maybe
he's
less
sure
he's
going to finish.
The interviews I've seen with him say, it's like, well, this is my creation, that's theirs.
Yeah.
yeah.
Let them go down
that,
their own
that's,
path.
That's what they did with that.
He was, he,
I think, too, that being a TV guy for so long, he's probably more comfortable with letting
license.
Them do their thing than somebody who,
with
like, who doesn't have any connection with that.
I just think it would interrupt what he wants his next book to be. Somewhat, because he's gonna, I mean, he may be jerking his audience back, saying, that's not how I'm doing it.
I don't think he'd have a problem doing that, though.
I don't think he'd have a problem.
I don't think he'd give it a second thought. Yeah, I think he'd be like, guess what?
But where's the integrity, I guess?
Jon Snow's still dead.
Because you allow someone else
it's,
to...
It's,
what a better way to show you are the, like, ultimate world creator than to say,
you
know...
You take a book and you make a movie out of it, right? Because lots of movies do not...
follow the book.
Yes.
They're not faithful
yeah.
to the book.
No.
But
well,
but
some authors
can
really
continue. This is an ongoing saga.
Some
for
don't.
Example, Philip K. Dick wasn't happy with Leiber.
Like so much
yeah.
of something like that.
So, I mean, it's a legitimate issue.
It's a question, I guess. It's,
yeah,
it's,
yeah.
I don't know what more.
I think that, I mean, there, some of the stuff that has been revealed might actually be in the sixth book. We don't know. Like, maybe Jon Snow does get brought back to life, you know.
My impression is that Martin is just so comfortable with his own creativity.
Yeah.
It's like, I'm doing my thing. You do your thing.
Yeah.
Whatever.
I think you get a kick out of it.
Yeah,
right?
He doesn't
like,
have anything to prove to anyone. That's
I mean,
pretty
I can
weird.
See that. It's just, you know, you're just offering your work for something.
And I don't think
too.
He's going to lose the fans.
No. We're
because
doing
the
findings.
People who are fans of the books can't wait for the next book to come out.
Yeah,
you are. Yes.
Did you put the wrong in the calendar?
Yeah, probably.
I'd like to see another picture crossed.
All right, well, let's... bring it to a close. I'll once again thank the library, and thanks to all of you for faithfully attending and having, you know, great questions and comments and
I don't
things to
that
say.
Right,
so.
Thank you.
Oh, sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Thanks.